Third speaker of the day, Tomasz Jakubowski from Wrocław University of Science and Technology, who will talk about optimal Hardy inequalities for the fractional Laplacian on LP. Welcome.
Thank you very much for this invitation and this opportunity to give this talk. I will talk about my recent paper with the same title as the title of this talk, joined with Krzysztof Bogdan, Jura Gęczewska, and Katarzyna Pietruska-Pałuba. It is submitted. We don't have reviews yet, so wait, but I present the results. So plan of the talk is as follows. I will give some definitions at the beginning, later motivations. Later, I will give the results of this paper, and at the end, I will give some insights into the proofs or other interesting connections with these results. I think I will start with reminding of the recalling the classical Hardy inequality. It was proved over 100 years ago by Hardy. And it states that if we take a derivative of a function and we take an integral of the squared derivative, it is bigger than the integral of a squared function divided by its square. And here we have some constant. It is exactly 1/4, and this is the best constant in this inequality. It can be generalized to the case when we integrate over the space Rd, and we have the very similar form. Derivative is changed to the gradient of a function, and we have a different constant here. Of course, for maybe not, of course, because we have a different domain of integration, but if we take d equal to 1, we have the same constants here. It's not obvious, but this constant agrees here. Now we have some generalization of this Hardy inequalities, and I will talk about the generalizations. The first one was maybe not the first one, but one of the generalization was made by Fitzsimmons in 2000. He considered the Dirichlet form E. This is a Dirichlet form for Laplacian, for example, the Dirichlet form E. And if L is the generator of this Dirichlet form, H is a superharmonic function, non-negative superharmonic function. And if you consider such a ratio, L over H with a sign minus divided by H, and we multiply by U square, then this Dirichlet form is bigger than this expression here. For example, if we take Laplacian, we act with Laplacian on a function, the power function with negative power, we obtain some constants here, and we have x to the power b minus 2. This constant may be calculated explicitly and will be given later. And if we divide it by the same function, we obtain exactly this expression, because x to the power minus b cancel, and we get this expression with some constant. Okay. However, I call this slide classical Hardy equality because one of the possible ways to obtain Hardy inequality is to get Hardy equality. So we have the same expressions on the left, on the right side of the formula, but we have additional term which makes this inequality equality. So if you consider the power function h, then this Dirichlet form for Laplacian is equal to such expression. We have the same integral, but multiplied by some constant, plus some reminder here. And this reminder is non-negative. And if we take the value delta to equal to such a number, it is in fact the value which maximizes this expression here, we get that the great squared gradient of a function u, integral of this, is equal to this expression which is in the hard inequality plus something positive. So from this we can obtain the hard inequality, thus writing that this right side is bigger than this one because of the negativity of this expression. My aim is to consider fractional Laplacian instead of Laplacian. I will recall the definitions here. So we'll consider the number d, natural number d, with the dimension of the space, and alpha will be between 0 and 2. And we consider a Levy measure density denoted by nu. We have some constants a, d, alpha given here, multiplied by the just power function, the negative power. And fractional Laplacian is a principal value of such integral with we have this measure mu, and we have such integral. It is the definition of a fractional Laplacian. Now we will consider the bilinear form E of such form. So it is in fact, if we multiply fractional Laplacian by function W and integrate, we will obtain this formula for the sum plus a function. And now for a moment we are interested in the quadratic form. So we take W equal to U, and we have such expression for definition for this quadratic form. And domain of this quadratic form is just all the function u from L2, such that this integral converges. And in the mentioned paper already, Bogdan did that team proved such hardy identity or equality for this quadratic form for fractional Laplacian. So we have this quadratic form defined on the previous slide, and it is equal to such expression. We have again the squared function u divided now by x to the power alpha instead of x to the power 2. We have some constant here, this ugly for gamma functions, and we have some non-negative reminder, because function h here is just a power function. It's non-negative, numerator is non-negative, so we have non-negative function here integrated. So we have very similar situation or very similar formula as mentioned here for Laplacian. Again, we have a quadratic form here. We have this integral with some constant and some non-negative domain. I will say a few words about this constant kappa. In fact, this is a function kappa, depends on delta. We note here that this function delta is symmetric with respect to delta, to the point d minus alpha over 2. Generally, if you put alpha equal to 2, some of the formulas here becomes the formula for Laplacian. Especially this constant kappa delta for alpha equal to 2 becomes the constant which is this here in this formula. Okay. I will show the picture of this function. It is very similar to the squared function. It attains its maximum at this point. And this constant here for delta equal to d minus alpha over 2 is also called the Hardy constant. And it is the best constant in a fractional Hardy inequality. because again, if we take here in this equality, the maximum value of this constant here, so we take the delta such that we have the maximum, the rest is positive, so we have this inequality. To prove that this is best constant is we have to do some additional work, but this inequality holds, of course, due to this equality. Now I will introduce Bregman divergence. So we will use the notation a to the power k, it is called branch power. It is just a power of a, the value of a, multiplied by sine of a. So this is the power with the sine. And now for p between 1 and infinity, we define the Bregman divergence as follows here. It may look strange, but if we take p equal to 2, it reduces to b minus a squared. Generally, for even integers p, if p is an even integer, it may be given by some very nice formula. It is not important here, but what is characteristic here that this expression b minus a to the power 2 appearing is characteristic for this Bregman divergence, because some comparability follows with this expression. We have also that this function fp is non-negative. It is not very clear from this expression, but for example, if we consider b bigger than a and it's bigger than 0, and we take the difference between, okay, we don't have to use this modules. We write it as an integral of such form. Now it is clearly bigger than the b minus a, and we take the smaller value, possible smaller value of this expression. It is p a with p minus 1. And we get this inequality that fp is bigger than 0. Generally, if you consider the function x to the power p, then this function fp is a second order remainder of the Taylor expansion of this function f. And since this function is convex, the second order remainder is non-negative. This is the general reason why this function fp is non-negative. Now, we have such a comparability of this function fp. It is comparable with such expression. Here we have this b minus a squared times something. And what is more important for us, it is comparable with such expression. So we have a to the power p over 2 minus b to the power b over 2 squared. Next fact is that fp is not symmetric. Generally, we don't have such equality, so we have equality here, but we can consider the symmetrization of this function. So we take the sum and we take divide by 2, and we have a symmetric form. Now this form is symmetric, and it is similar to the b minus a squared, because but we have here other powers. And we have also such comparability It was mentioned here, but here we have the exact constant. For us, this constant for a moment is important one. So this symmetrized Bregman form is estimated from below by this expression times such constant here. Now we will pass to the Sobolev-Bregman form, which we call P form. So we consider this, it will be noted by EP. It is just this expression, this symmetrized Bregman divergence integrated with respect to the measure mu with against dx and dy. Now we would like to, our aim is to write a Hardy inequality for this P form here. The first approach is to apply this inequality from the previous slide. We have that this expression here, which is under integral, is bigger than this expression. And for if we put instead of b and a function u and x, we have just the quadratic form. And we can use the fractional Hardy inequality to obtain such inequality here. So we take this P form, we estimate it by the quadratic form from below with some explicit constant. And from this constant, using the fractional Hardy inequality, you obtain the second constant, kappa at the point b minus alpha over 2. This is the best constant, the fractional Hardy inequality. So we have Hardy inequality for this Bregman form with some constant. And the question is whether this constant is optimal or not. In this inequality, this one, this constant is optimal, but we made here another, we have here another inequality, which is due to this inequality, which is not optimal, or for some A and B, there is no equality here. So the question is whether this constant may be improved. And our our hypothesis was that we can improve this constant, and we looked for the better one. Why we thought that the one reason was that this constant is not optimal here, but the second reason comes from the classical case when alpha is equal to 2. We have such inequality. This is mentioned Hardy inequality. And if we consider such expression, this is the corresponding P form for Laplacian. And we use some calculations, we obtain that this P form is estimated by exactly the same thing as in the Hardy inequality, this expression is integral, times this constant. And this constant is exactly the same as in the, on the previous slide, but we have this kappa function for Laplacian, but this constant is the same. This is why we would think that the constant here is optimal. But if we look better at this constant, we may see that this is equal to the constant kappa d minus 2 over t. So maybe instead of this constant here, it's better to put this one and consider kappa d minus alpha over p as the possible best constant in the this hard inequality for p4. And it turns out that it was a good shot and our hypothesis was true. We wanted only to, we had only to prove it. And how to get this constant? For p equal to 2, the way to achieve this goal was to write this hard equality and maximize this constant kappa here. For p not equal to 2, you would like to do the same, proceed similarly. So we would like to write this expression, this integral here, with some constant, and write here something non-negative. It depends on delta. So the first thing was to write a good equality with a good constant here. And this constant should be such that maximum of this constant is equal to kappa d minus alpha over p. It was our hypothesis. But the question is what this constant is here, how to obtain it. The result is as follows. It wasn't easy to find it. So we have some range of the parameters alpha and delta. I don't want to discuss it, but generally we have that this Bregman form is equal to such constant. We have two convex combination, in fact, of the two function kappa, of two constants kappa, plus some reminder, which is non-negative because function fp is non-negative. So we have non-negative function here. Function h here is just a power function as before. And in particular, this expression here attains its maximum at the delta equal to d minus alpha over p. And the maximum is just kappa d minus alpha over p. This is due to the symmetricity of this function kappa. The second result is the optimality, because here we have that we can improve this constant, but we still don't know whether this constant is the best one. Maybe we can improve it further, but it turns out that it's not possible. So this inequality, the result is that this inequality is optimal. So this constant is sharp, you cannot improve it. We can calculate that our constants, new constants, kappa d minus alpha over p is bigger than the previous one. Here is a picture. We have this dashed graph is the smaller constant and our new constant is the solid line. Next results. This hard inequalities are connected with the semi-group generated by this operator. So this is the Schrödinger perturbation of the fractional Laplacian by such a potential. This potential is critical and not very easy to handle with. I will talk maybe a little later about it, but generally it is well defined, or it exists, the semi-group generated by this operator only for some range of the values kappa. If kappa, the value kappa is too big, this semi-group does not exist, and this range is up to this best fraction, best constancy fractional hard inequality. So this constant also gives this maximum range of the kappa for existence of the semigroup. And you would like to consider this semigroup on the function on the space LP. And the first result is that this operator is a contraction of LP on LP if this constant kappa is smaller than this our best constant in this P form hard inequality. It's hard inequality for P form. We recall here that for Laplacian, very similar result was proved earlier by some authors independently. And our last result is that this operator is bounded for some range of parameters. Of course, if it is contracted, it is also bounded, but not all bounded comparators are contracted. So this range is bigger. And you can see on the picture for this range for the theorem 3 and theorem 4. The theorem 3 is marked by red lines and 4 by blue. This is drawn here. We have delta, and on the other x, we have 1 over p. It is better to consider this picture when on, we have 1 over p on the vertical x. Okay. Of course, delta cannot exceed d minus alpha over 2 because this is the range for existence of a semigroup. So delta cannot be larger than this. Maybe a few words about theorem 1. We recall that this number alpha is between 0 and 2, and we have this measure nu. And now we will consider a small function pt, which Fourier transform is just e to the power minus t to c to alpha. And of course, we have by the because of convolution of ps and pt is just ps plus t, so this forms a semigroup, and we denote by pt xy the pt at the point x minus y, and we consider the semigroup pt given by this expression. And fractional Laplacian is the generator of the semigroup. So for some class of function, we have such convergence of this expression to fractional Laplacian. Now, it is well known that this function pt has such estimates. In particular, we have estimates for pt over t. It is estimated by the measure nu. And you also have this that the limit as t goes to 0 of this expression is just the measure nu. And now for u from the function LP and v from the conjugate space, we consider such an approximate quadratic form as this scalar product of these two expressions. And we have that if u is in the space LP, then this p form can be expressed as a limit of this function of this approximating quadratic form expressions pt. And we also have that if u is in the domain of the generator on the space LP, then this p form can be expressed as the scalar product of fractional Laplacian on u times e to the power of p minus 1. Now, how we prove theorem 1? Maybe we look into the case p equal to 2, which was handled by Bogdan, Dida, and Kim in the mentioned paper. So we consider the function h And we note the fractional Laplacian of the such power function is just the same function h times x to the power minus alpha multiplied by some constant. And now we consider this approximating form, et, and we do some manipulations. We something add, subtract and add, and we obtain two expressions, it and jt. And now here we can see that this expression here converges to fractional Laplacian with minus over h. And from this expression here, it is kappa delta h of x minus x to the power minus alpha. So h cancels here, and we obtain that it converges to this expression. And jt, if we write this expression with integrals, we see that it may be expressed in such a form. And after symmetrization, because we see that this measure here, or this expression here, is symmetric with respect to x and y, that if we symmetrize it, we obtain this form. So jt now converges to this integral, which was given before, because this converges to the measure here. And we obtain the result for p equal to 2 in such a way. And the problem is that if we mimic this approach and we do some very similar manipulations to the expression for this expression, we obtain such result. And it is not a good one, because this expression here is not non-negative for all function u from the domain. This constant here is too big one, is too big, as we will see later. But this expression is also useful, and we used it for other purpose. But for example, to see that this function is not always non-negative, we recall that function h is x to the power minus delta. And if we take u, x to the power some beta, and if we take beta such that b to the power t minus 1 is bigger than delta and this bigger than beta, we obtain that one of this expression is negative and one is positive. So the whole integral will be negative. Of course, this function is not in a domain. It is not integrable, so this, it would be infinity, but it suggested that this expression can be made negative. And we used it later. The right approach here was to consider three integrals instead of two. So we add something, divide, add, subtract, divide, multiply to this expression here and obtain three integrals. And now this one, as before, converges to Laplacian on function A. This converges to Laplacian on function A to the power P minus one. And we have this the same situation that this converges to nu. And we obtain our result. The main difficulty was to guess how to split this expression and what constants should appear here. Okay, now a few words about theorem two. So from theorem one, we have such inequality and we'd like to prove that this is this constant is the best one here. So we want to show that if we take an epsilon bigger than zero, we can find the function u in the domain of the Bergman form such that opposite inequality holds. So we have this equality, and we have also this other representation, which was obtained by the, say, wrong approach, which does not give a good constant here, but it turned out that this is a very nice result to obtain optimality of the constant. Because this expression here can be made negative. So if it is negative, we have canceling it, we have opposite constant. So maybe I will show a picture showing the graph of these two functions, kappa or two constants here. We have one constant is before this integral, this one, and the second is this one. And we see that this blue one attains its maximum at the point p minus alpha over p, but this kappa delta still increases. So if we take a bigger constant here, somewhere here, bigger constant, it corresponds to some kappa here. So we can find a kappa such that this constant is too big because it's bigger than this one. And going back to this representation, we can look for the function u, which reverses this inequality here. And it turns out that the good candidate is a power function, is x to some negative, the minimum of two power function. We take, for such a function u, it turns out that this expression here, it's the same expression as before, but written in the, with this power function here instead of function h, this integral becomes negative for some function u. But here to obtain the goal, so to obtain this optimality of the constants, we had to struggle with some integrability issues for u, because for some range of p, this function is not in the domain of this p form on LP, because the function is not in LP generally. So we had to regularize at infinity this function, and the proof becomes very technical and long, but the general idea is to consider this function. Okay, I will pass to theorem three now and say a few words about this semigroup with tilde. So you would like to construct the fundamental solution of such equation. So we have here we have this generator of this semigroup with tilde. So take the function q and recall the function pt and such a sorry, I have to do something because. So we have a function p with such a Fourier transform, and we recursively define function pn by such integrals, and define the function p tilde as a perturbation series of a function pn. And we, from this definition, we get that p tilde satisfies such equality. It's called Duhamel formula or perturbation formula. And it gives that p tilde is a fundamental solution of this equation. It is not very easy to study this density PT lambda because it is not comparable with the function PT. Generally, for a large class of perturbations, the resulting density is comparable with the original one, but here it is not. It has some singularities at the origin with respect to X and Y. Now, we consider the semigroup P tilde using the kernel P tilde PXY. And if we take some function f from the domain of fractional Laplacian, and we put the function u px as a P tilde acting on f. Since P tilde is a fundamental solution of the equation considered from the previous slide, u is the solution to the Cauchy problem, not the Cauchy problem, with the initial condition given by function f. And if we now consider this equation here, take the p power of both sides, on the left side, and integrate it, we obtain here the derivative of a function u times some expression, and using that the derivative of function u is given by fractional Laplacian plus q times u, we obtain on the right side our Bregman form of the function u with the sign minus plus the integral which appears in our Hardy inequality. And if now q delta, I recall that q delta is just kappa delta x to the power minus alpha. Now, if this constant is smaller than the optimal constant, and we from the graph of the function kappa delta, we can see which constants are good for us. We see that this expression is negative. Hence, this integral is a decreasing function, and we obtain that maximum value is at zero, and maximum value at zero is just the p norm of f. So you obtain that p tilde or on f, the p norm is smaller than p norm of f. So we have this contractivity of the operator pt on f. And everything works if kappa delta is smaller than our optimal constant, because so this our struggle to obtain the best constant was important to obtain the best range for contractivity here, for example. Some remark about our function p tilde in a recent paper 2015, we obtained estimate for this function. We see that this is it has singularities at zero, x to the power minus delta, the same as this function h, which appears here during all the talk here. And I will pass to some last remarks. Okay, remark about boundedness of PT on LP follows directly from this estimate. So you use this estimate, you understand that boundedness is equivalent to some estimates or inequalities on delta. And theorem 4 follows directly from this estimate. Some last remarks are what we learned from studies this problem was that this Bregman form may be written in such such a integral, and it is comparable to the quadratic form, but due to some other powers, but this comparability may be a trap because we lose accuracy of a constant and we cannot obtain the optimal results in other situations. And the last remark is that symmetrization is not always a good way to handle with some expressions. Symmetrized expressions are very nice because it is easier to look at the symmetric expression, but it was, for us, it was a trap, and we struggled a lot with looking for a optimal constant, because we symmetrized the expressions and we couldn't obtain the right result. So this symmetrization should be avoided in some situations. And some literature at the end here during the talk. And thank you.
Thank you very much. Wonderful talk. Any questions, suggestions, comments?
I have a question. If I may. Tomasz, I wanted to ask you about this one of the results concerning the extension of this interval where you construct the contraction semigroup and then extend it to a bounded semigroup for a larger interval of piece.
Theorem C and 4, yes?
Right, exactly. So I was just curious, in the local case, this phenomenon, it's known for the entire class of form-bounded potentials. And I was wondering if you thought about proving something similar in the non-local case. So not only for Hardy potential, but for the sort of a larger class.
Larger class of potential than Hardy, you mean?
Yep.
Still with a fractional Laplacian, but which class you mean?
What is sometimes called form-bounded potential. So the potential such that basically you have a Hardy type inequality. Instead of this is your condition on the potential, something like that, which would include potentials in the weak LD over LD over alpha space.
You mean still potentials with respect to fractional Laplacian?
Yes, with respect to fractional Laplacian.
We didn't think about such a thing. But I think there are many open problems here with arises and some generalizations made here. So all problems are here to study are very interesting, I think, and not easy. All these critical situations are not easy to handle. But we didn't think about such more general potentials here. Mm-hmm.
Thank you. may I ask another question?
Of course.
Thank you. Just general question. So you talked about your motivation, but still, how did you notice this? Just out of curiosity, because it's easy to trick yourself into thinking that this suboptimal constant is what you need, right? But you notice this this improvement.
You mean how we found optimal constant, or
Yeah, how did you, yeah, exactly, yes. So you have this inequality on one of the slides, the previous slide, or the, was it the next slide? Oh, no, the next slide, I'm sorry.
This one?
No, after, the slide after. Yes, exactly. So this inequality in the middle, on the left, on this inequality in the middle, on the left, you have your optimal constant, and on the right, something suboptimal. Mm-hmm. But it's easy to trick yourself into thinking that by analogy, this must be true. So I was wondering, and have to admit, that's what I thought. I was wondering, how did you notice this sort of...
It was, how to say, for me, I thought that, as I said, this first thing was that to obtain this inequality with this rock constant, we use here inequalities of on the expressions under integral, which may cause that this constant is too small, when smaller than the optimal one. As I said, I tried to look at the classical case, and I noticed that we have such equality here. This constant is optimal, but this constant is also given by expression with kappa. And I think for me, it was good. Sign that we can improve this constant. It was was my way to obtain it. But you're right. It seems we look at this constant generally is the same as here for Laplacian. So why it should be something different? But I don't know. I can't remember why we looked farther for this constant. Mm-hmm. The fact is that this here is this content is bigger. Mm-hmm. You can do it by calculations or picture.
Well, it's just I thought that maybe you ran some numerical simulations first and something like that.
But to make numerical simulations with the integrals and finding the optimal constant was too hard for.
Mm-hmm. Okay. Thank you.
More questions, comments, or suggestions? Well, if not, let's thank Tomasz again. Thank you.